Hi guys. Today I'm going to do solutions for Codeforces Global round 11. And another round hasn't ended yet, as you can see by the timer, but like, just I've read F and G and H, and looking at the solves on them, like, it's just, I don't think I'm going to, especially in only 12 minutes, there's no way I'm going to solve them. So instead, I'm going to be productive and make the video. So as we discussed before, I'm not doing screencasts for rated rounds, or rounds that are rated for me, but I will still do solution videos for them. And I solved A to E, so we can get into those. Right now, I'm doing pretty well. There's no IGM, sadly, unless there are system tests that go my way, but I mean, it's still a really good performance. I'm happy with it. So let's just do solutions. Okay. Those are my scribbles for E. So here we go. In A, we have an array, and we want to rearrange it in some way such that all prefix sums have some zero. Okay, now if the whole array, now let's let S be the sum of AI. So if S is equal to zero, then like, I mean, the whole array is a prefix sum, which means that no matter what we do, no matter how the elements are ordered, if S equals zero, then it's not going to be possible to make, it's not going to be possible because like the whole array is a prefix sum and the whole array's sum is zero and there's nothing we can do. So if the sum is zero, then it's not possible. Otherwise, there are two cases. Say the sum is greater than zero. For example, this sample we have, -4, -3, -2, -1. Okay, now the sum is greater than zero, which means that this is going to be greater than zero. The sum of this. So basically what we want to do is, if the whole sum is positive, like one strategy we can do is just to keep the sum positive for every element. And the way we can do that is, we can put all the negative elements at the end. So let's say we do it like this, 4, 2, negative 3, negative 1. Then what happens is this sum is positive. So now once we remove this number, because we just removed a negative number, this sum is still going to be positive. So now we remove the next negative number, and because we just removed another negative number, the sum is still going to be positive. So now we get to the point of removing positive numbers. However, all of these are positive numbers. So we have an array of positive numbers. And obviously, obviously the total sum is going to be like greater than zero, because it's just positive numbers. So if we put all the positives at the beginning and then the negatives at the end, then we'll have a solution. What do we do about zeros? With zeros, we have like we just. Because like all of these prefix sums are positive anyway, we just need to put zeros anywhere that isn't the beginning. So we can put them, say, between the positives and negatives or at the end. But between the positive positives and negative is convenient because to make this sort of like implementation work, all we have to do is sort the array in descending order. Because in that, for that, all of the positive elements will be in the front, all of the zeros will be in the middle, and all of the negative elements will be at the end. So for S being greater than zero, we just sort in reverse order. And for S is less than zero, then like what you could do is you can kind of imagine like flipping the sign of all of the numbers, and then the sum would be greater than zero. So then we want to reverse sort it again. However, this time we have negative numbers, but I mean, it's still possible, like by the same argument. But this time we want the negative numbers in the front and the positive numbers in the end, so we could just sort it normally. And that's the solution. So if S is zero, there's no solution. If S is greater than zero, you can sort it in reverse, and if S is less than zero, you can sort it normally. Yeah, that is A. Let's do B. B is kind of sketchy, actually. I don't really know, like, if I will pass, but that's a good, hopefully a good chance. Okay, so like what's going on with this? We have a bunch of W's and L's, right? So L, L, W, W, or L, L, W, L, WLLWL. Let's take this string. Okay, now any W that doesn't have a W to the left of it is only going to contribute 1 point. So we have a fixed number of W's we can have. It's like, say you count the number of W's, then it's the minimum of N because we can only have like N positions in the string, and the count of W's plus K. So automatically, what we're going to, like, automatically, we're going to have this many W's, which means that all of these W's are going to contribute plus one. And what we're interested in is finding, is maximizing the number of W's that have another W to the left of it, because that way we'll, like, get a better score. So then the remainder is just finding the number of, like, good W's, the ones that contribute two. And consider it like this. Say we have this W here, and we want to, like, stick something to the left of it, and therefore we'll do better. And so we can, say, put the W here. And then so we get this one, but then this one has something to the left of it. Like, it doesn't have a W to the left of it. So while we increase this one is now, like, we need another one for this one. So now we'll have to, like, make it here and make this a W. And then now there's a W to the left of both this and this one. So now we get, like, extra for both of them. So it's kind of, like, weird to describe, but every time we sort of fill in a gap between W's, we get an extra plus one. Because when we close this gap, the W we put down that closes the gap will it will add two to our score instead of just one, because this one has a W to the left of it, and the W that we put it to the left of also has a W to the left of it. So just by changing this one to a W, if this one's already a W, then we get plus two from this one. So then it becomes optimal to now close as many gaps between W's as we can. Let's say there are no W's. So CW equals zero. This is a special case I had, although I don't even think it's necessary. Then it's just, the answer is 2K minus one. Or, the maximum of 2K minus one and zero. Because we're going to have exactly one group of W's. Like, we'll have some L's maybe, and then some W's, and then some more L's or something. But no matter what, we're always going to have one W that has something to the left of it. And the rest of the W's, we can put them down, like, adjacent so that this is the only W that doesn't have a W to the left of it. Which means that we get two for everything except for one of them, so it's just two times the number minus one. And if we have no W's to put down, we want to make sure we don't put negative 1 as our answer, so we just maximize it with 0. Because if K equals 0, then we'll have negative 1. So in otherwise, CW is greater than 0. Then what happens here? Well, again, we want to close out as many of these gaps as possible. So we can do this in sort of a greedy fashion, because we only care about the size of the gaps, not where they are. And another implementation detail is that you can't fill in the gaps on either of the ends. So you only care about the gaps between W's. This is all sort of implementation. So now, let's just, like, put these gaps in some array and then keep taking the smallest one every time. So if we get a list of the gaps, then we can sort that list, and then we can greedily take as many gaps as possible. So for example, here we have 1 and 2. Then say K equals 2. Then we go through the list in ascending order. So 2 is greater than 1, so now we can fill in this gap, and we used 1, so now k equals 1. 1 is less than 2, so we can't, like, fill in this one, so this is still existent. And then there are no other gaps. So we filled in one gap, which means that, like, essentially our string is going to be www, and then l, and then we can, like, put another w anywhere, it doesn't really matter. As long as we attach it adjacent to some W, and then that's it. So here we have two groups, and in the same regard, we have two W's that are unmatched, that don't have a W to the left of them. So the answer is two times the number of W's we end up with in the final string, which is this. Two times, it's the minimum of N and the count of W's plus K. And then this minus the number of groups we have. Be careful to distinguish between the groups of L that you might want to find in implementation and the groups of W that you want to minimize. Like the groups of W is equal to the groups of L plus 1. But yeah, this is the idea I had for the formula. And to find these groups of L's between the W's, you can kind of just like do two pointers. What are the constraints? 100,000. Okay, but you can do two pointers basically, and that will just work. If you don't know how two pointers works, you can kind of check my code or learn it, I guess. It's a cool tactic to know and comes up more often than just in this problem, so I recommend just like knowing it. Yeah. Okay, but anyway, that's it. That's what I have. Okay, C is lame. Yeah, so I mean kind of. There's some interesting parts to it, but like I don't really know. Where are we right now? 96th, we still have plus 59. That's pretty good. That is pretty good indeed. Okay. Wait, what? Did we just go up a place? How do we just go up a place? Did someone like get an unsuccessful? Oh. Huh, he just tried to hack someone and went below. That's sad. Okay, but anyway, this is like really good. We're gonna get very close to IGN if we pass system tests, that is. So okay, let's do C. So we have this grid and we have like a bunch of celebrities. I don't remember the flavor text, but it's like just some stuff going on. And we want to visit as many celebrities as possible. Okay, so. And we start up here. So let's consider the first celebrity. Like, either we go and visit it, or we don't. Either we go and visit the celebrity, or we don't. So if we don't, then we can use the time that we don't visit this celebrity to possibly visit some other celebrity in the future. For example, say this is going to come at time 5, and this is going to come at time 6. So we could visit this celebrity at time 5, because it takes us only 4 distance to get there. But then now that we're here at time 5, wait, does that, it should be 7, yeah. But now that we're here at time 5, it takes us 3 moves to get down here, but we only have 2 units of time, so we can't visit both. But say we don't visit this one, then instead, we could have used the time we spent waiting here to instead go to 7. And so we can visit 7. So let's say we visit some, like, I'm going to use, like, C1, C2, C3 for celebrities. Let's say we visit, like, the 1st, the 3rd, the 6th, the, I don't know, 9th, why not? Nice. And let's say we visit it in this order, right? So then our path is only going to consist from going to C1 to C3, going from C3 to C6, and going from C6 to C9. We don't really care about the intermediate steps that we took to get there. What this is basically saying is, say we're visiting some celebrity CK, then And actually, we can kind of make implementation easier by saying we start off at celebrity C0, and then we can one index the rest of them, and that makes it so like we don't have to do any special cases for starting off. So to get to CK, we're going to have to come from some other celebrity, possibly including the initial position. So that's a question mark, not a letter. And then this is only possible if we if this distance is less than like less than or equal to like TK minus T of whatever we come from. And we don't really care how we got here. We only care about the number of celebrities we have, because both the time and the position of this point is fixed. We only care about like the maximum possible number of celebrities we could have done to get here. And so this calls for a dynamic programming solution, where you have dpi represents the max number of celebrities you can visit where you're ending at CI, where the, like the last celebrity you visited is CI. Okay, and the way this works is then the answer is the maximum over all I of DPI, because we can like end at any celebrity. That's not a problem. Like we don't always have to end at the last one. We could do whatever we want. And then what's the recurrence? So DPI, so we visit I, which means we already like automatically gain one to our visited. So it's one plus, it's like the maximum over all J of DPJ, but we can only consider a J we can only consider values of J where like the distance from I to J is less than or equal to the time it takes or the time difference between I and J, like the arrival times. Okay, and for like convention, if, by the way, this is a J, not an I. So for convention, if this doesn't exist, like if there's no celebrity we can come from, even like the initial position, then we'll set it to like negative infinity because like there's no way we can even get to that celebrity in time. So we shouldn't consider it as a possibility. Okay, but this is like a problem, right? Because like this is n squared and n is 10 to the fifth. So that is indeed a problem, right? Oh, we got A, cool. Kind of scared about B. The rest of them I'm fine on, I guess. I'm confident about. Because I specifically tested my E with a validator. While I was trying to look at F and G, I ran code that tested my E for all possible values of N. So I'm very confident that we'll pass. But anyway, so this is like a problem. Because this is N squared. So we can either speed, we have two things to speed up. We can speed up this transition, or we can somehow reduce the number of states. But like, how do we even reduce the number of states? Like we have N celebrities, we just can't do that. So we have to speed up this transition somehow. And the way to do that is, notice that the size of the street is at most 500. R is less than or equal to 500. What this implies is that the maximum distance between any I and J is less than or equal to, well, it's the movement between like one corner and another corner. Nice. It's the movement between one corner and another corner, so it's 2 times R minus 1. So for any celebrity that's farther, for any celebrity where the difference in time is greater than this, like, we're automatically done. Yeah, for any celebrity where the difference in time is greater than this, we're automatically done because, like, we automatically can come from that celebrity. So the bottleneck here is like checking if this is true, and then over all ones where this is true, we take the maximum. But say we sort the celebrities by time, which is how they're already sorted. Then say we iterate through J in decreasing order. So J equals I minus 1, and then to 0. As soon as we get to a point where Ti minus Tj, the difference in times, is greater than or equal to 2 times r minus 1, then we automatically know we have enough time to visit all celebrities that are less than or equal to j. So what we can do is we can define another array, let the maximum of I be like the maximum, it's like the prefix maxima over this DP. So it's like the maximum like the maximum of this, of all the DP values from 0 to I. So once we get to the point of this J, we can use this maximum value instead, because all we have to do now is, like, we know we can get all the celebrities before or at this one, which means we only care about the maximum of all celebrities, the maximum, like, of the DP values of all celebrities that are further than this distance away, which is exactly this. So to compute maximum, it's simple. It's the maximum of DP of I, and the maximum of the first I minus 1 values. Because the only thing that changes between this and the previous one is that we get this one. So basically, we compute this DP. The answer is the maximum over all these values of DP. And what we want to do is we want to find this maximum efficiently. And to do this, we can like naively iterate through all the celebrities that are close enough to be interesting. And then when the time of visiting, because all times are distinct, when the time of visiting gets to a point where no matter where we are, we're automatically going to be able to visit it, then we use this maximum array once instead of going through all the DP values. And that works. So what's the complexity? Well, for each value of DP, we go through at most 2 times r minus 1 states. And then finally, we take the maximum. So the DP is O of n times r. All right, we got these three. Nice. So this DP is O of n times r. I'm actually kind of scared on D2. I don't know what to do about that. But yeah, n is 100,000, r is 500. We have 2 seconds. That's enough to pass. So that's the solution. By the way, if you want to get an overview of my like scribbles, you can see it right here. Or if I zoom out a bit more. Okay, yeah. It's a video. You can pause if you want. I'm kind of scared about D now. All right, well, D is weird. I am not a fan of it, but it is a problem, so let's do it. I'm not going to read the statement. Well, basically, you want to sort an array and you do some like weird operation for it, right? So, 7, 5, 2, 1, 4, 3, 6. Let's take that as a sample. Okay, so in one move, you can like pick some ranges, and you can like treat all of these ranges as individual elements and then reverse the array of ranges. So that means that this range would go to the first position. So you'd have 4, 3, 6. Then, no, blue. And then this range would stay in the middle. So you would have 2, 1. And then this range would go to the end. So you would have 7, 5. And that would be your new array. You can pick like any set of ranges you want. And using this operation, you have to sort the array with no more than n operations. Is it strictly less or no? No more than n operations. Okay, so here's how this works. Here's how it might work if I don't fail system tests. I'm scared, actually. I am very scared about this. Because it's kind of sketchy. There are no multi-tests, so there are problems here. So on. Like, just what's happening here, right? Well, okay. So let's. All right, I don't know how to build up to this. This solution came from me, like, trying completely random things until I kind of just pieced together something that works. So the first step is that, like, if. Consider some array like. Consider some subarray like this. So you have 3, 1, 2, 4. Like, this group of 1 and 2 is already sorted. And. So, like, because this is already sorted, there's no point in doing any operation that splits these two apart because they're already sorted. Like, they're already in the order that you want them. So, in a sense, you can kind of merge these two elements into one, where it's kind of like it's a range of contiguous values that is, like, between 1 and 2. So you could represent, like, 2 and 5, for example, as the numbers 2, 3, 4, and 5 in specifically this order. If you have something like 2, 3, 5, and 4, then it's not sorted. So this would be, like, 2, comma 3. This would be a range from 5 to 5, and this would be a range from 4 to 4. Okay. There are at most, I mean, obviously there are at most n of these groups. So, now, they're at most n of these groups. So what we kind of want to do is, we want to, in every operation, we want to merge these, we want to merge two of these together. So somehow we either want to get like 1, 2, 3, and then we can merge the 1, 2 and the 3, 3 into 1, 3, or we could, for example, get 3, 4, 3 and 4, and or we could, no, that's it. I mean, we could do it all at once, too, like 1, 2, 3, 4, and then we'll be done. But anyway, the goal of this operation is to reduce the number of ranges by 1. Because when you the final range you want is 1, comma, n. And this will only happen when you have exactly one range. So if in every move you can decrease the number of ranges by at least 1, then, like, you're just done. It just works. Okay, now how do we decrease the ranges by at least 1 every time, right? So let's consider the compressed array, where we compress ranges into single elements. Either, like, the whole array is sorted, in which case we have exactly one element, or it's not sorted, then we have some inversion. An inversion is a pair of two elements where the one before it is greater than the one after, which means that, like, it contributes to the not sortedness of the array. Right, so what happens here? Well, we have to use the fact that we have an inversion. Can we create an inversion? Can we turn an inversion into something that we... Like, can we kind of flip this inversion around? And actually, we don't only want an inversion. This is a mistake I made in my own implementation, hence the wrong answer on pretest 6. But we want... Yeah, we got it. All right. We got it. We got D. That's great, because I tested my E with a validator, as I said before, which means that I think I'm just guaranteed to, like, pass system tests. So D was the only one that was sketchy, and we just got it, which is awesome. Okay, so now, yeah, that is awesome. So now we're gonna do some stuff. Yeah, we can't just have an inversion. What we want is, we want, like, consider this range. We want to, like, extend this range, kind of. And to do that, we need the element that... Like, we need the element that... we need the element that comes right after, the element or the range. So to merge this with something else, we need 3 and then something else. Okay, so even though it's only clear that there's some inversion, because if there's no inversion, the array is sorted. In fact, if there's some inversion, then there's also an inversion where some element that should be after this is actually before it, which means that there's something of the form A, B, and like some C and then A minus 1, which means that we can merge these two into the range C, B. There's always going to be something of this form. It could be anything, though. There could be some elements in between them. There can be some elements on either ends. But what we want to do is we want to use the operation to make it so these elements are right next to each other. Okay, so first of all, finding this is simple. We look at all elements. We look at this, and then we look at all elements that are after it, and then we check, is their maximum exactly equal to this minimum minus 1? And then if so, then we just consider this pair and we can ignore everything else. All right, now how do we do this? Well, this is the structure we're going to have. We might have something in between them. We might have something here. We might have something here. But as it turns out, it doesn't matter. So let's consider the cases. Say we only had these two elements. Then we could just put a bar right between them, and then we would swap them, and then we would be done. Okay, say we have this. Then we can put a bar here, and we'll put a bar here. Then we'll swap these two, and this will be at the beginning, so it's all chill. Now say we have this, for example, and maybe not this. Then we could still put a bar here, or here, or anywhere, actually. Because no matter what, this is going to be at the beginning, and this is going to be at the end. So we put a bar here, we swap these two, and we'll be done. Okay, say we have this, but not, so we have this, for example, but not the other ones, then what we can do is we can put this here, put two bars here, swap these two, and we'll be done. So now we consider combinations of these. For example, if we have something here, then if we have something here and here, we can put this bar, for example, here, and then this bar here. And then we'll swap these two, and we'll be done. Or we could have something, these two. I'm kind of just doing out all the cases and showing that it works no matter what. We can have these two, in which case we'll put a bar here, and put a bar here, and then these will be swapped and we'll be done. Or we could have specifically these two, but then we can put a bar here, put a bar here, and put a bar here. Then these two will be swapped, and we don't really care what happens to these two. And if we have all of them, then we could do the exact same thing. We can put the bar here, here, and here. And then these two will be swapped. So you don't have to go back in the video and check all the cases, but basically no matter what we have here, here, or here, putting the bars in these three locations are going to work. It's going to specifically make it so these two elements are adjacent, which is exactly what we want. Because then it merges their ranges together and we have one less element in our range array and we're just happy. Right? Okay. So once we do that, basically we just need to put these three bars down. Although it's kind of redundant to it's not allowed to put this bar down if we don't have any elements on this end. So if this doesn't have anything, then we don't put this bar down, and same for this, but that's just a simple check. That is that's just checking if this element is at the beginning of the compressed array, and if this element is at the end of the compressed array, because otherwise we'll have stuff on either side of them. But yeah, basically we put down these three bars, and doing that will let us swap these two and then make them consecutive. So basically, like, every time we're going to do an operation, first we create the compressed array, and then we find any two elements that create this sort of structure, that is, like, putting them together would merge them, where the bigger one is after the, or before the smaller one, which, again, is always possible because there's at least one inversion. Then we do the operation, and in terms of implementation, it's probably a good idea to, like, actually apply the operation to the whole array. And then next time we'll recompress, refine the pair until we have exactly one pair of 1 and n. So how many operations does this use? I think it's at most n minus 1, because we have n, like, n ranges. Each one will decrease it by at least 1. And so it takes m minus 1 decreases to do all that. So that is how you do D, kind of disoriented. Now we check E. Actually, what I want to do first is I want to see how system tests are going. That is, have people failed system tests is my question. And if so, where? Whoa, so D, D, C, E, interesting. How many sys test fails are there? Whoa. Okay, just to hear. So this is like A, who are failing C? My answer on test 16, interesting. Okay, honestly, this solution for E is so stupid. I'm really, like, I just thought of random things, and then I verified it with code, and it just happened to work out. Like, this is not how you should solve problems. And I'm very sure what I have is not intended, but, I mean, it works. It passed. As you can see, it passed system tests, so I don't know what to say. Wow, this had, like, a way higher runtime. How weak were the tests before? I mean, you could just, like, have all the times be consecutive and then it would max out the runtime. But, anyway. Okay. So the first thing is that here's kind of how I came to the solution. What, like, we have some number and we want to, like, find out some series of operations that will let us do as many things as possible. Like, for example, we can get the sum of two elements. Can we get the difference of two elements? Can we get maybe the product or the, like, A divided by B? What can we do? If we can get A divided by B, then we can divide A by all of its divisors, and then we can get 1. So if we can find some, like, operations, and if we could subtract, then we can subtract, say, A minus 1, and then we'll have 1. But unfortunately, I'm not sure if it's possible to do either of those. Instead, what I found is something else. So the goal is to have something like this. You want two numbers, x and x plus 1, where x is even and x plus 1 is odd. And then when you take the XOR of x and x plus 1, then all of their bits are going to be the same except for the one bit. So you have, like, dash, I don't know, just like AAA 0 and AAA 1. These don't necessarily have to be the same, but all of these are the same, like, they're the same to each other. So the total XOR is going to be 1. So this is our goal. Let's kind of work backwards from this goal. And, even if these aren't even and odd, because n itself is odd, like, if this is odd and this is even, then, like, we could add n to these. Like, we could add n to both of these, and then n plus x and n plus 1 plus x both of these will, that will work. Like it'll give us an answer. So basically we just need two consecutive numbers. Okay, how do we do that? So this is our goal. We want x and x plus 1, both in the array. So now let's increase our power. Right now we can get a XOR B and we can get A plus B. But let's be a bit greedier. Let's go for the product of two numbers. Okay. Now, multiplication is repeated addition. So we can kind of just like add a bunch of times until we get something. But that's like inefficient. We don't have that many operations. We only have 100,000 and the number is up to 1,000,000 minus 1. So that's a problem. But we don't have to necessarily do repeated addition. If you know how the concept of binary exponentiation works, then consider some number in binary, right? And we want to compute x to the k quickly. So let's first compute x, and then x times x is x squared, so we can do that. Then x squared times x squared is x to the fourth, so we can do that. Then x to the fourth times x to the fourth is x to the eighth. Right? And conveniently in binary, this number represents 1, this number represents 2, this number represents 4, and this number represents 8. So for binary exponentiation, we can compute all of these, and there are O of log n of these numbers we have to compute, or O of log x. Actually, no, sorry, O of log k. Then if we represent k in binary, then we can like take some r equals 1. And then if the first bit is set, then we'll multiply it by x. And then if the second bit is set, then we'll multiply it by x squared, so now we have x cubed. And then if the fourth bit is set, which it isn't, then we'll multiply by x to the fourth, but instead we just like multiply by 1 or whatever. And then the fourth, or the, this was the third bit, the fourth bit is set, so we multiply by x to the eighth. And then we get x to the 11th, as we want, because this number is 11 in binary. It is notation for bases. So x to the 11th. All right, now that's kind of a brief overview of how binary exponentiation works. And if that was confusing or too fast, you can check out some other tutorials. Two pointers and mod x. I'm gonna remember what I did. So I'll leave like links to some places where you can learn these, maybe in the description or something. But anyway, the whole point of this is that you can compute x to the k in O of log k. So with this, we have a similar two operations. We can take a plus a and compute 2a, or we can take x plus a and then we can get x plus a. So we can either multiply a by 2 or add a to something. So this is the exact same principle. Let's say we want 11 times a. Then we can compute a, 2a, 4a, and then 8a. And we can use the same principle of binary exponentiation to say r equals 0 plus a plus 2a, we don't include this, so this is 0, and then plus 8a. And then in total we get 11a. So this takes O of log n operations to compute, and this is also O of log n operations adding these, or log k, I guess. So essentially with this trick, we can get any multiple of any number that we already have on the blackboard in O of log of the multiple. So now we have three operations. We can do a XOR b, we can do a plus b, or we can do a times b. And in fact, we haven't even used XOR yet. So this is like the sketchy part. This is my solution to E, and it's like really stupid. But what I did was, say you have some n. Since we can get any multiple of n, the trick is, if we can get two numbers, c and d, where they're coprime, that is, their GCD is 1, then by like Chinese remainder theorem or something, we can there's going to be some multiple of C and some multiple of D where there's going to be some multiple of C and some multiple of D where, like, the difference between these two is 1. So this is, like, just something that is known. I think it's Chinese Amanda theorem that can be used to prove it. I'm not really sure, but it just is true. So only this is only true if they're, like, GCD is 1, though. And it's kind of like the idea of modular inverse, I guess. So you can think of it that way. That is, you can say that it's like the number where x times c is equal to 1 plus y times d. Or this is the same as saying x times c is equal to 1 modulo d. And the way to do that is, like, you can use modular inverse, you can use whatever. What I did is brute force, but basically, because it, like, works out, but you just need to solve this equation, basically. So, x and y should be positive. C and D are obviously positive because they're on the blackboard. So that part's fine. So, now we can do multiplication. So now we want... So continuing to go backwards through the solution, we want two numbers, C and D, that are coprime, where the GCD of C and D is equal to 1. Okay. So, like, there are a lot of ways you can do this. What I did... And I did not prove this in any way. What I instead did was I kind of just wrote a program to check it and then see if it was possible. But what I did was, for any n, you want to find some I such that I times n XOR I plus 1 times n is coprime with n. So it is the GCD of n. And this number for some I is equal to 1. And my program basically verified that, like, for any number, this isn't that big. Like, the required value of I isn't that big. And I guess it's because the numbers themselves aren't that big, which is kind of just, like, I don't know. But the highest number I would ever require is, I guess I ran out of space, but the highest possible I, so it's like the maximum over all n of the I that, like, is required to make this true is, like, less than, like, is, like, 500,000 or so, which is totally fine. It means we can just, like, brute force this value of I before even starting to do the operations, and then we can do that. Oh, wait, this is 500,000. Okay, so, I don't have any sort of intuition of why this works. I didn't, like, I told you it was randomly guessing how I came up with this, so it's very stupid, but this is basically the way to do it, or the way I did it, and it works. Find some I such that the GCD of n and I times n, XOR I plus 1 times n, is 1. Then you have two coprime numbers. This number is, because this value of I is small, this is O of n squared, which means that, like, the highest number you'll ever use is O of n cubed, which is fine because n is 10 to the 6th, and the highest number you can have is 5 times 10 to the 8th. So you won't overflow, nor will you exceed the bounds. So it's, like, totally fine to be able to do that. Maybe there is some proof, like, some more formal proof that, like, this is small enough to work. But once you brute force this I and you figure out this value, then call this value v, you have two coprime numbers, n and v. And the way to get this v is just to take two different multiples of n, which you can do in n log n, or no, log of I, I guess. And then once you do that, you can, of course, go backwards and find some solution to this equation where c times n minus d times v is equal to 1, or the other way around, which is to say c times n is equal to 1 modulo d. And you already know that c and d are coprimes, so to do this, you can apply something called the extended Euclidean algorithm, I think that's what it's called, which basically just like solves this equation in O of log something, so it's fast. But what I did in my code was just brute force it, because like, if you consider like the multiples of, like, let d be the bigger number. Wait, is that how I did it? It was like, yeah, like consider, no, wait, sorry, this should be 1 mod v, and then you want to find like two numbers. Okay, so like, yeah, so consider some value of d times v. Then, like, you only need to check if this is equal to 1. So, basically, it's saying that c times n minus 1 is equal to d times v. Or, at the same time, c times n is equal to 1 plus d times v. So, if n is divisible by this number, then the appropriate c is just 1 plus d times v over n. And so that's your value. And then d is, like, you fixed the value of d, so you already know it. Then you have these two values, and they're consecutive. So now you do the final part, which is XOR them. Or if they aren't, like, consecutive in a way that works, add n to both of them, and then XOR those. And then you'll get 1. So the whole, like, hard part of the solution is this part, finding the I and, like, showing that the I actually works. And I don't know how to prove it. But the maximum possible I you'll ever need is, like, small. It's, like, 520-something thousand. But that's the idea behind my solution to E. Okay, as for F, G, and H, I have no idea. So I will leave it at that. Yeah, I will leave it at that. So those were ADE solutions. And I guess my rating is going to be even higher now. It's going to be like very, wow, very, very close to IGN. That's sad though. We didn't get there because we're so close to it. It's even closer than like I was to IM beforehand. But you know, last time we got this close, it followed with a absolutely devastating loss. So who knows, man. Maybe we'll get IGM next time. This round. Wait, who are these authors? Are they? I feel like I've done a round by them before. Okay, that's fine. 2582. Okay, frustratingly close. Anyway, that's ADE. I think I'm going to stream tomorrow because of the edgy round is like very early in my time zone, but I can do it later. So we'll figure out something. Anyway, that's it. Goodbye.